السابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين اتبعوهم بإحسان.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، so today then we arrive at the hadith of Abu Muhammad Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يكون هواه تبعا لما جئت به. That none of you will truly believe until his desires are in line with what I came with. Meaning his desires are in line with the commandments that is permissible, the commandments of the affairs that are permissible, and the prohibitions staying away from them. That his desires and his wants are in line with that. Remaining in the halal, staying away from the haram. This hadith has some speech of the scholars regarding it. However, the meaning, as Al-Shaykh Al-Fawzan highlights here, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ, that none of you will truly believe حَتَّى يَكُونَ هَوَاهُ تَبَعًا لِمَا جِئْتُ بِهِ, until his desires, his inclinations are in line with what I have come with the revelation that I have come with. والحديث وإن كان فيه مقال, as Sheikh Al-Fawzan says, this narration does have some statements and speech surrounding it, meaning in terms of its authenticity, whether this hadith with this wording is actually authentic or not. But he says, Al-Imam Al-Nawawi considers it to be authentic, and there are several other scholars too who do consider this narration upon this wording to be authentic. And he says, وَيَشْهَدُ لَهُ الْقُرْآنُ أَيْضًا, that in any case, the meaning is testified to by the Qur'an. So even if this narration upon this wording was not accurate, it was not a hadith, then at the minimum what you can say is that the meaning of it is true. Because in the Qur'an, there are ayat that testify to this same meaning. An example of that is in Surah An-Nisa, ayah number 65. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ. That by your Lord they will not believe until they make you the judge in the affairs that they disputed over between themselves, and then they do not find in of themselves any hesitancy upon what you judge. فَيَكُونُ هَوَاهُمْ تَبَعًا لِمَا حَكَمَ بِهِ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. So their desires are in line with what the messenger judges by, that they will accept his judgments upon the affairs, that they will not have any hesitancy against the judgment of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ولا يكرهون ما حكم به النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And neither do they dislike what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم judges and rules. They do not have a disliking to the sunnah, to the commandments. فَمَنْ كَرِهَهُ كَانَ كَافِرًا. Someone who dislikes and hates the commandments, the sharia, is a disbeliever. If you hate the commandments, you hate the sharia, then that person is a disbeliever, the Shaykh says. قال تعالى, as Allah said, ذلك بأنهم كرهوا ما أنزل الله فأحبط أعمالهم. And that is because they hated that which was revealed upon them from Allah, and so their actions were destroyed because of their hatred for what was revealed to them from Allah. Their actions were destroyed thereafter. فَهَذَا الْحَدِيثُ يَشْهَدُ لَهُ الْقُرْآنُ. So therefore this hadith is attested to by the Quran. The same meaning is there, that you must be in line with the commandments and the sharia, and love that sharia and the rulings that have come, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has judged all of that and ruled all of that for you upon wisdom, complete wisdom, knowing what is good for you and what is best for you. And so a person has his desires in line with the sharia, in line with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he came with, yani. وَمَعْنَ هَذَا أَنَّ الْإِنسَانَ يُسْلِمُ لِلَّهِ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلَا يَعْتَرِضُ. The meaning is that a person therefore submits to Allah and His Messenger and does not object to them. وَلَا يَكْرَهُ مَا جَاءَ عَنِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. And he does not dislike what has come from Allah and His Messenger. وَلَوْ كَانَ فِيهِ مَشَقَّةٌ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ. Even if there is a burden or a difficulty upon yourself in doing that commandment, fulfilling that obligation, there may be some difficulty in some affairs, but even if that is the case, then you do not object, you submit to the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَعَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَصْبِرَ وَيَعْرِفَ أَنَّ هَذَا هُوَ عَيْنُ الصَّلَاحِ وَالْخَيْرِ لَهُ. And a person must be patient and recognize and know that this is exactly what the rectification for him is and the goodness for him is in implementing the sharia. That is exactly where the rectification for him comes from, and exactly where the goodness for him is in. وَلَوْ كَانَ فِيهِ مَا يَشُقُّ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ أَوْ يَثْقُلُ عَلَيْهَا. Even if there are some rulings that are difficult for you, and they are burdensome upon you, and it requires effort to fulfill them, despite that, you submit and you accept and you fulfill the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ حُفَّتْ بِالْمَكَارِهِ. Because indeed, paradise is surrounded by the affairs that are so dislikes, the affairs that are difficult. It is surrounded by those difficult affairs. It requires effort to reach paradise. قال تعالى وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. That perhaps you dislike an affair, but in reality it is good for you. وعسى أن تحبوا شيئا وهو شر لكم. And perhaps you love something, but it is actually bad for you. Maybe you dislike something, but it is actually good for you. And maybe you love something, but it is actually bad for you. Allah knows and you do not know. وَهَذَا يَقْتَضِي أَنَّ الْمُسْلِمَ يُسْلِمُ لِلَّهِ وَلِرَسُولِهِ. So this necessitates that a Muslim submits to Allah and His Messenger. وَيَعْلَمُ أَنَّ الْمَصْلَحَةَ وَالْخَيْرَ فِيمَا جَاءَ عَنِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. And he knows, he must recognize and understand and comprehend that the goodness and what is good for him is in what Allah and the Messenger gave. وَلَوْ كَانَتْ نَفْسُهُ فِيهَا اسْتِثْقَالٌ أَوْ تَبَاطُؤٌ عَنْ ذَلِكَ. Even if you find some type of burden in yourself in being able to perform that, it's an action that is difficult. Waking up for Fajr is difficult for some. And so these types of affairs, you must be patient upon it. Isha in the summer months is late, but be patient upon it, fulfilling the obligations. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And so Allah says, indeed, He knows and you do not know. Meaning Allah knows what is good for you and you do not know. Then we come to the final hadith in this book. The final hadith from the 40 hadith of Imam al-Nawawi. And that is the hadith of Anas ibn Malik رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول قال الله تبارك وتعالى يا ابن آدم إنك ما دعوتني ورجوتني غفرت لك على ما كان منك ولا أبالي. يا ابن آدم لو بلغت أو لو بلغت ذنوبكم عنان السماء ثم استغفرتني غفرت لك ولا أبالي. يا ابن آدم إنك لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا ثم لقيتني لا تشرك بي شيئا لأتيتك بقرابها مغفرة. رواه الترمذي وقال حديث حسن صحيح. This particular narration reported by or collected by Al-Imam Al-Tirmidhi, and he mentioned that it is a Hasan Sahih narration from Anas ibn Malik. He says, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, so it's a hadith Qudsi, Ya ibn Adam, O son of Adam, meaning people, إِنَّكَ مَا دَعَوْتَنِي وَرَجَوْتَنِي غَفَرْتُ لَكَ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنْكَ وَلَا أُبَالِي. That as long as you make dua to me, you call upon me and you have your hopes in me, then I will forgive you whatever your affair may have been, and I do not care. I will forgive you. And O son of Adam, even if your sins get to the levels of the sky, but then you seek forgiveness from me, I will forgive you and I do not care. O Ibn Adam, if you were to come to me with an earth full amount of sins, but you meet me not having committed shirk, any partners in association to me, then I would come to you with the similar amount of it with forgiveness. In this hadith, there are different sentences or different sections. The first section where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing all of mankind. In the first section, Allah says, Ya ibn Adam, innaka ma da'awtani wa rajawtani ghafartu laka ala ma kana minka wa la ubali. يعني من أحسن ظن بالله عز وجل وتقرب إليه بالعمل فإن الله يغفر له الذنوب والسيئات. Meaning that if a person has good thoughts of Allah, a person has good thoughts of Allah سبحانه وتعالى and seeks closeness to Allah via his righteous actions through dua and having hope in Allah, performing his actions and deeds, having good thoughts of Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives the sins of that person and the wrongs of that person. لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ عَلَى مَا كَانَ مِنْكَ. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the oft forgiving and the oft merciful. He forgives what may have occurred from you, whatever that may be. فَالْإِنسَانُ يَكُونُ عِنْدَهُ مُخَالَفَاتُ وَمَعَاصِ. A person no doubt falls into oppositions and wrongdoings that occurs from a person. وَلَكِنَّهُ إِذَا أَحْسَنَ ظَنَّ بِاللَّهِ وَتَابَ إِلَى اللَّهِ. But if a person has good thoughts of Allah and repents, seeking forgiveness from Allah, وَلَمْ يَقْنَطْ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ, and he does not lose hope in the mercy of Allah, واستغفر, and seeks forgiveness from Allah, طلب المغفرة من الله, غفر الله له جميع الذنوب. Then Allah سبحانه وتعالى forgives all of his sins. قال تعالى, as Allah said in the Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَصْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Say, O my servants who have wronged themselves, do not lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Indeed, Allah forgives all of the sins. هذا فيه حث للإنسان على أن يتوب إلى الله ولو عظمت ذنوبه. This is an encouragement from Allah for the servants to repent no matter how great their sins may be. فيتوب ولا يقول هذا ذنب لا يغفره الله بل الله تعالى يغفر جميع الذنوب. So a person should never say, but this sin Allah is not going to forgive it. Rather, Allah forgives all of the sins. فَيَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. So he repents to Allah. وَيُبَادِرُ, and he should hasten to seeking that forgiveness from Allah. Hasten to repenting for his wrongs. وَاللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ غَنِيٌّ كَرِيمٌ لَا يَضَرُّهُ شَيْءٌ لا ينقص من ملكه أو مما عنده شيء. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the rich, the generous. Nothing harms him, and it will not decrease from his kingdom one bit or from what he has. So you repent and seek forgiveness, and Allah forgives, and it does not decrease from his dominion whatsoever to do so. ففيه حسن الظن بالله. So by doing so, it shows your good thoughts of Allah. وتعلق القلب بالله, and your connection of your heart to Allah, that your heart is connected to Allah. If you are the one who hastens to seeking forgiveness and repents for the wrongs immediately. وَاللَّهُ نَعْمُ وَعَدَمُ الْقُنُوطِ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. And a person does not fall into losing hope from the mercy of Allah. وَأَنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَا يَتَعَاظَمُ ذَنْبًا عَلَى التَّوْبَةِ. And that a person never thinks any sin is too big to make repentance from. A person never thinks that any sin is too great to repent from. فَاللَّهُ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. For indeed Allah forgives all of the sins. That is the opening line of this hadith. The second line of this hadith, يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ لَوْ بَلَغَتْ ذُنُوبُكَ عَنَانَ السَّمَاءِ رَتَبْنَعَ. O ابن آدم, if your sins were to reach to the skies, that many sins reaching up to the sky, ارتفعت من الكثرة حتى تبلغ السحاب. That you have so many sins, they pile up to the clouds. That's how many sins you have. ثم استغفرتني غفرت لك ولا أبالي. But then, even if that's how many sins you have, you seek forgiveness from me and I will forgive you. Allah says, فَهَذَا فِيهِ أَنَّ التَّوْبَةِ تَجُبُّ مَا قَبْلَهَا مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ مَهْمَا كَثُرَتِ الذُّنُوبُ وَتَعَاظَمَتْ. So this indicates that tawbah wipes out, repentance wipes out that which came prior to it from the sins, no matter how many and how great they may have been. Even shirk. A person is upon shirk, but then he repents and accepts Islam. It wipes out that which came before it. وَلَوْ تَرَاكَمَتْ وَارْتَفَعَتْ إِلَىٰ عَنَانِ السَّمَاءِ فَإِنَّهَا تَهْدِمُهَا. And even if they added up and added up and were so high they reached the clouds to the sky, فَإِنَّهَا تَهْدِمُهَا. Then even then, tawbah, repenting, seeking forgiveness, crushes all of those sins and wipes them out. التَوْبَةُ الصَّحِيحَةُ الْمُسْتَوْفِيَةُ لِشُرُوطِهَا. And that is when it is the correct and upright and sincere tawbah, sincere repentance with all of the conditions in place. And what are those conditions? أن يُقْلِعَ عَنِ الذَّنْبِ. Firstly, obviously, that you stop doing that sin. You cannot be repenting from the sin sincerely if you are still doing it and carrying on with it. So you must stop that sin completely, stop it and finish it if you are to make a sincere repentance. Secondly, أن يعزم أن لا يعود. That you make a firm, resolute decision that you will never ever return back to that sin again. You make that firm in your mind that you're not going back to that sin again. Thirdly, أن يندم على ما حصل منه. That you regret the fact that you fell into that sin. You regret having done that sin, having fallen into that sin. You regret that. A person who doesn't regret having done the sins and then is repenting afterwards, thinking, okay, I'll repent now, but it was good whilst I was doing it, then that is not a sincere repentance. If you are sincere, then you would be shy in front of your Lord for having done that wrong. Not be happy that you're glad you did it, but now you're going to change. You regret that evil and wrong that you fell into, and that opposition against Allah, your Creator, you fell into. So you regret and you have sadness over what you did. And also from the conditions, إِذَا كَانَ عِنْدَهُ مَظَالِمُ لِلْعِبَادِ يَرُدُّهَا إِلَيْهِمْ. If your sin is connected to some third party, then you must return their rights to them as well. Return their rights to them and seek pardon from them, that they pardon you and they excuse you. هذه هي التوبة الصحيحة. This is the correct and the true repentance. وهذه هي التي تهدم الذنوب وإن بلغت عنان السماء. And this is the type of repentance, the true and sincere repentance, that wipes out the sins even if they have reached the clouds to the sky in the amount that you have done. ففيه الترغيب في التوبة. So the hadith is an encouragement to repent. وحسن الظن بالله عز وجل. And to have good thoughts of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. والمبادرة والمصارعة إلى التوبة. And to hasten to repenting, to hasten to seeking forgiveness from those wrongs. Then we come to the third section of the hadith. And this is the greatest section of it. As Shaykh Al-Fawzan says, وَهِيَ أَعْظَمُ وَأَعْظَمُ. And this is greater and greater. And what is that? It is that Allah says, يَا ابْنَ آدَمْ إِنَّكَ لَوْ أَتَيْتَنِي بِقُرَابِ الْأَرْضِ خَطَايَا ثُمَّ لَقِيتَنِي لَا تُشْرِكُ بِي شَيْئًا لَأَتَيْتُكَ بِقُرَابِهَا مَغْفِرَةً. That, O Ibn Adam, if you were to come to me with an earth full of errors, but then meet me not having committed shirk though, then I would come to you with the likes of it in forgiveness. With an earth full equivalent forgiveness, wiping out all of those sins and wrongs. So the narration says, لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض. If you were to come to me with an earth full, that amount, a whole earth full amount of sins, يعني ملء الأرض الواسعة, فلو ملأتها أو ملأتها كلها خطايا. If you were to fill the whole earth with your sins, ولكنك سلمت من الشرك بالله عز وجل. But you kept yourself free and clear of ever falling into shirk though. All of these other sins, they were not shirk. You kept clear of shirk. But you filled the earth with all these other sins that you did. فإنك لا تيأس من مغفرة الله لك. And when you die upon that state, do not lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Because no matter how many sins you have done, then you have not fallen into shirk yet. You did not fall into any shirk. So neither in this world do you lose hope from that. You have not fallen into shirk. You have fallen into all types of other sins. They can all be forgiven. And in the afterlife, when you meet Allah, as long as you have not committed shirk, the other sins can still be forgiven too. And this is as Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive that you commit shirk alongside him, associate partners alongside him, but he forgives all else to whom he wills. فَالذُّنُوبُ الَّتِي دُونَ الشِّرْكِ هِيَ تَحْتَ مَشِيئَةِ اللَّهِ. So the sins that are lesser than shirk, they will all be under the will of Allah on that day. إِنْ شَاءَ عَذَّبَ صَاحِبَهَا ثُمَّ أُخْرِجَ مِنَ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ وَإِنْ شَاءَ عَفَ عَنْهُ مِنْ أَوَّلِ وَهْلَةٍ وَلَمْ يَدْخُلِ النَّارِ. If Allah wills, that person may be punished for a while in the hellfire, but then he'll be extracted because he never committed shirk. And then he'll enter paradise. And if Allah wills, maybe he'll just be forgiven from the get-go, from the start, and entered straight into paradise. It is possible. فَدَلَّ هَذَا عَلَى خَطَرِ الشِّرْكِ وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ وَأَنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَا يَصِحُّ مَعَهُ عَمَلٌ وَلَا يَطْمَعُ صَاحِبُهُ بِمَغْفِرَةِ اللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يَتُبْ مِنْهُ فَمَنْ مَاتَ عَلَى الشِّرْكِ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ لَهُ. So this indicates to you the severity and the danger of shirk. That this is the one action that all your other deeds would not count alongside. Because the one who is upon shirk, all of his other deeds are wasted. All of them are destroyed. So whomsoever dies upon shirk, that cannot be forgiven. وَمَنْ مَاتَ عَلَى التَّوْحِيدِ وَلَوْ كَانَ عَاصِيًا فَاسِقًا مُرْتَكِبًا لِكَبَائِرِ دُونَ الشِّرْكِ وَفِيهِ سِعَةُ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ وَعَفْوِهِ. And if a person dies upon tawheed, even if he was a sinner, then he can still be forgiven, even if there were major sins, as long as it was not shirk. So this indicates the greatness of the mercy of Allah. In the Quran, it tells us, "Inna Rabbaka wasi'ul maghfirah." Indeed, your Lord is of expansive forgiveness, of a great amount of forgiveness. And so the scholars, they say, any type of shirk, major or minor, cannot be forgiven on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Minor shirk included. They say it is not forgiven, many of the scholars. And that means if a person dies upon some form of minor shirk, they will definitely be punished in the afterlife. But the only difference is with minor shirk, you do not stay in the hellfire forever. But many of the scholars, they say, if you commit minor shirk, some of the affairs that are minor shirk, you will not be forgiven for that. You are definitely punished for that, because Allah says He does not forgive shirk. And they say that includes both types. That is the opinion of many of the scholars. And then, هذا حديث عظيم فيه هذه الجمل الثلاث التي فيها البشارة لأهل الإيمان وأهل التوحيد وفيها الإنذار لأهل الشرك والكفر بالله عز وجل وحثهم على المصارعة للتوبة من الكفر والشرك قبل الموت. So this hadith is a tremendous hadith with these three sentences or three sections in it, which are a glad tidings for the people of Iman, and they are a warning to the people of shirk and disbelief, and an encouragement for them to hasten to make tawbah, to repent from their kufr and shirk before death comes, because whoever dies upon shirk, فَلَا طَمَعَ لَهُ فِي مَغْفِرَةِ اللَّهِ, then there is no hope for him, for the mercy of Allah, for the forgiveness of Allah. But as for the one who dies upon Tawheed, even if he has sins, then he can still be forgiven on the Day of Judgment. And even if he is punished, then the punishment will not be eternal. He will be removed from the hellfire eventually and placed into paradise. And that is the final hadith in this particular book. And so the Shaykh says at the end, وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدُ عَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ انتهى هذا الشرح المبارك في فجر يوم الاثنين. He mentions that Shaykh Al-Fawzan, he finished this explanation on the 21st of Dhul-Qa'dah, the 11th month of the Islamic calendar in 1427. Which is 18 years ago, 1427, 18 years ago, or 17 years ago on the calendars that are familiar, that the Shaykh completed this explanation of the 40 hadith of Al-Imam An-Nawawi. So these are tremendous narrations. Every Muslim should pay attention to all of these hadith in this book. So many great lessons to be learned from each one. And it's not just about reading through them and saying, I finished it, I did the 40 hadith. It's about remembering them and acting upon them. They mention about some of the scholars of hadith When they would memorize a new hadith, it would only be moments later that you would see them implementing what they had memorized. Immediately in their actions and behavior, they would start implementing what they learned and read and memorized in that hadith. That is the purpose of knowledge. The whole point of knowledge is to act upon it. The ilm is for al-amal. Knowledge is sought for the purpose of acting upon it. So it's very important to take the benefits of these narrations, to learn them, memorize them, remember them. And it's a tremendous book that the scholars, they teach again and again. So it is something that should not be forgotten. So we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having blessed us with the ability to complete the whole book, to go through all of the narrations, and particularly the manner we've done it here, which is almost all of the explanation of the Shaykh al-Fawzan, almost all of it, we read through it as well in the lessons, every hadith, the full explanation practically. So it is a complete explanation of the 40 hadith from the explanation of the Shaykh al-Fawzan, hafidhahullah ta'ala. So that is where we conclude that. Insha'Allah ta'ala then, from next week onwards, we're going to start a new series of lessons, a new book. And the book that is going to be started next week is a short one. It will only take maybe 5 sessions to finish, something like that. It is a small book written by a Sheikh Abdullah Ibn Salfir al-Zafiri, Hafidha Allah Ta'ala, from the scholars of Saudi Arabia. A very small book, Al-Rakaiz al-Ashara fi al-Tahsil al-Ilmi, the 10 foundations for acquiring knowledge. How do you remember all of this? How do you keep that in your mind? We've just done the 40 hadith, and we're going to do other books inshallah in the future. How do you make sure as a student of knowledge, you're learning knowledge properly and you're remembering that knowledge? That is what this book is about. And the basis of this book is from Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i. Al-Shaykh Abdullah Al-Zahiri wrote that book based upon what Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i had written. In fact, 60% of the book is Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i's. And then 40% the Shaykh added on further points and benefits and extra chapters. So it's a small book, only 10 chapters, but they are very short chapters. It won't take more than a few weeks to complete that, but it will be highly beneficial for a student to understand how to study properly, how to study these books and learn the knowledge and maintain it and memorize it. So inshallah ta'ala, that is the book we'll do, the 10 foundations for the acquisition of knowledge based upon originally the works of Al-Imam Shafi'i. So that's going to be a few sessions, and then after that we're going to start the next new book, which is also going to be of Shaykh Abdullah Al-Zahiri, regarding Haqiqatul Manhaj Al-Salafi, the reality of the Salafi Manhaj, where he explains all aspects of this religion, of this methodology of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So that is the plan going forward, inshallah ta'ala. We'll conclude upon that for today then. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.